Señora Presidenta,
Madam President, Excellencies, Heads of State, Heads of Government,
y alto representante
High Representatives of the Governments of the World,
muy buenos días.
Good morning
a todos y a todas.
To all of you.
En primer lugar,
first of all,
quiero invitarles,
I would like to invite you very respectfully
no hayan podido leer este libro,
to those who have not read this book,
leamos.
To read it.
Noam Chomsky.
Noam Chomsky, one of the most prestigious
de esta América y del mundo.
American Chomsky. And world intellectuals. Noam Chomsky, and this is one of his most
Hegemonía
recent books, Hegemony or Survival.
Hegemonía o supervivencia.
Hegemony or Survival.
La imperialista,
the imperialist
Unidos,
strategy of the United States. It's an excellent book to help us understand what has been happening in the world throughout the 20th century and what's happening now, and the greatest threat looming over our planet, the hegemonistic pretensions of the American Empire are placing at risk the very survival of the human species. We continue to warn you about this danger, and we appeal to the people of the United States and the world to halt this threat, which is like a sword hanging over our heads. I had considered reading from this book, but for the sake of time, I shall just leave it as a recommendation. It reads easily. It's a very good book. I'm sure, madam, you are familiar with it. It appears in English, in Russian, in Arabic, in German. I think that the first people who should read this book are our brothers and sisters in the United States, because their threat is in their own house. The devil is right at home. The devil himself is right in the house. And the devil came here yesterday. Yesterday, the devil came here. Right here.
En este mismo lugar,
right here.
Huele a azufre todavía.
And it smells of sulfur still today.
Donde me ha tocado hablar.
This table that I am now standing in front of.
Señoras, señores,
yesterday, ladies and gentlemen, from this rostrum, the President of the United States, the gentleman to whom I refer as the devil, came here talking as if he owned the world.
Como dueño del mundo.
Truly, as the owner of the world.
Un psiquiatra no estaría de más.
I think we could call a psychiatrist to analyze yesterday's statement made by the President of the United States. As the spokesman of imperialism, he came to share his nostrums to try to preserve the current pattern of domination, exploitation, and pillage of the peoples of the world. An Alfred Hitchcock movie could use it as a scenario. I would even propose a title, The Devil's Recipe. As Chomsky says here, clearly and in depth, the American Empire is doing all it can to consolidate its hegemonistic system of domination, and we cannot allow them to do that. We cannot allow world dictatorship to be consolidated. The world tyrant's statement, cynical, hypocritical, full of this imperial hypocrisy from the need they have to control everything. They say they want to impose a democratic model, but that's their democratic model. It's the false democracy of elites. And I would say a very original democracy that's imposed by weapons and bombs and firing weapons. What a strange democracy. Aristoteles might not recognize it, or others who are at the root of democracy. What type of democracy do you impose with marines and bombs and... The President of the United States yesterday said to us right here in this room, and I'm quoting, anywhere you look, you hear extremists telling you you can escape from poverty and recover your dignity through violence, terror, and martyrdom. Wherever he looks, he sees extremists. And you, my brother, he looks at your color and he says, oh, there's an extremist. Evo Morales, the worthy president of Bolivia, looks like an extremist to him. The imperialists see extremists everywhere. It's not that we are extremists, it's that the world is waking up. It's waking up all over, and people are standing up. I have the feeling, dear world dictator, that you are going to live the rest of your days as a nightmare, because the rest of us are standing up. All those of us who are rising up against American imperialism, who are shouting for equality, for respect for the sovereignty of nations. Yes, you can call us extremists, but we are rising up against the empire, against the model of domination. The president then, and this he said himself, he said, I have come to speak directly to the populations in the Middle East to tell them that my country wants peace. That's true. If we walk in the streets of the Bronx, if we walk around New York, Washington, San Diego, in any city, San Antonio, San Francisco, and we ask individuals, the citizens of the United States, what does this country want? Does it want peace? They'll say yes, but the government doesn't want peace. The government of the United States doesn't want peace. It wants to exploit its system of exploitation, of pillage, of hegemony through war. It wants peace. Well, what's happening in Iraq? What happened in Lebanon? Palestine. What's happening? What's happened over the last 100 years in Latin America and in the world? And now threatening Venezuela. New threats against Venezuela, against Iran. He spoke to the people of Lebanon. Many of you, he said, have seen how your homes and communities were caught in the crossfire. How cynical can you get? What a capacity to lie. Shamefacedly. The bombs in Beirut with millimetric precision? This is crossfire? He's thinking of a Western when people would shoot from the hip and somebody would be caught in the crossfire. This is an imperialist fire, fascist, assassin, genocidal, the empire and Israel firing on the people of Palestine and Lebanon. That is what happened. And now we hear we're suffering because we see the homes destroyed. The President of the United States came to talk to the peoples, to the peoples of the world. He came to say, I brought some documents with me because this morning I was reading some statements, and I see that he talked to the people of Afghanistan, the people of Lebanon, the people of Iran, and he addressed all these peoples directly, and you can wonder, just as the President of the United States addresses those peoples of the world, what would those peoples of the world tell him if they were given the floor? What would they have to say?
Porque conozco la mayor parte del alma de esos
and
pueblos,
I
los
think
del sur,
I
los
have some inkling of what the peoples of the South, the oppressed nation, think. Say, that is what those people would say if they were given the microphone and if they could speak with one voice to the American imperialists. And that is why, Madam President, my colleagues, my friends,
el año pasado,
last year,
aquí,
we came here to this same hall as we have been doing for the past 8 years, and we said
algo que hoy está confirmado,
something that has now been confirmed, fully confirmed.
Aquí casi nadie en esta sala,
I don't think anybody in this room,
a defender el sistema de Naciones Unidas. Aceptémoslo con honestidad.
Let's
el sistema de
accept.
Naciones Unidas.
Let's be honest.
The
UN system born after the Second World War collapsed. It's worthless. Oh, yes, it's good to bring us together once a year, see each other, make statements, and prepare all kinds of long documents and listen to good speeches like Evo's yesterday's or President Lula's. Yes, it's good for that. And there are a lot of speeches, and we've heard lots, and the President of Sri Lanka, for instance, and the President of Chile.
Pero nos han convertido a esta asamblea
but we, the Assembly,
en un órgano
have been turned into a merely deliberative organ.
Sin ningún tipo de poder
we have no power,
para impactar de la más
no power
manera
to make
la realidad terrible
any
que vive el mundo.
Impact
por eso
on the terrible situation
Venezuela.
In the world. And that is
vuelve
why
a proponer aquí
Venezuela
hoy,
once again
este día
proposes
20 de septiembre,
here today, 20 September,
refundemos
that
las Naciones Unidas.
We re establish the United Nations. Last year, madam, we made four modest proposals that we felt to be crucially important. We have to assume these responsibilities, our heads of state, our ambassadors, our representatives, and we have to discuss these. The first is expansion, and Lula talked about this yesterday right here, the Security Council, both as regards permanent and non-permanent categories. New developing countries and LDCs must be given access as new permanent members. That's step one. Second, effective methods to address and resolve world conflicts, transparent debates, transparent decision-making. Point three, the immediate suppression, and that is something everyone's calling for, of the anti-democratic mechanism known as the veto. The veto on decisions of the Security Council. Let me give you a recent example. The immoral veto of the United States allowed the Israelis with impunity to destroy Lebanon, right in front of all of us as we stood there watching. A resolution in the Council was prevented. Fourthly, we have to strengthen, as we've always said, the role, the powers of the Secretary General of the United Nations. Yesterday, the Secretary General practically gave us a speech of farewell, and he recognized that over the last 10 years, things have just gotten more complicated. Hunger, poverty, violence, human rights violations have just worsened. That is the tremendous consequence of the collapse of the United Nations system and American hegemonistic pretensions. Madam, Venezuela a few years ago decided to wage this battle within the United Nations by recognizing the United Nations as members of it that we are and lending it our voice, our thinking. Our voice is an independent voice to represent the dignity and the search for peace and the reformulation of the international system, to denounce persecution and aggression of hegemonistic forces in the planet. This is how Venezuela has presented itself. Bolivar's home has sought a non-permanent seat on the Security Council. Let's see. Well, there's been an open attack by the U.S. government, an immoral attack to try and prevent Venezuela from being freely elected to a post in the Security Council. The Imperium is afraid of truth, is afraid of independent voices. It calls us extremists, but they are the extremists. And I would like to thank all the countries that have kindly announced their support for Venezuela, even though the ballot is a secret one and there's no need to announce things. But since the Imperium has attacked openly, this strengthened the convictions of many countries, and their support strengthens us. Mercosur, as a bloc, has expressed its support. Our brothers in Mercosur, Venezuela, with Brazil, Argentina, Paraguay, Uruguay, is a full member of Mercosur, and many other Latin American countries. CARICOM, Bolivia, have expressed their support for Venezuela. The Arab League. The full Arab League has voiced its support, and I am immensely grateful to the Arab world, to our Arab brothers, our Caribbean brothers. The African Union, almost all of Africa, has expressed its support for Venezuela and countries such as Russia or China and many others. I thank you all warmly on behalf of Venezuela, on behalf of our people, and on behalf of the truth. Because Venezuela, with a seat on the Security Council, will be expressing not only Venezuela's thoughts, but it will also be the voice of all the peoples of the world, and we will defend dignity and truth. Over and above all of this, Madam President, I think there are reasons to be optimistic. A poet would have said, helplessly optimistic, because over and above the wars and the bombs and the aggressive and the preventive war and the destruction of entire peoples, one can see that a new era is dawning, as Silvia Rodriguez says. The era is giving birth to a heart. There are alternative ways of thinking. There are young people who think differently, and this has already been seen within the space of a mere decade. It was shown that the end of history was a totally false assumption, and the same was shown about Pax Americana and the establishment of the capitalist neoliberal world. It has been shown this system to generate mere poverty. Who believes in it now? What we now have to do is define the future of the world. Dawn is breaking out all over. You can see it in Africa, in Europe, in Latin America, in Oceania. I want to emphasize that optimistic vision. We have to strengthen ourselves, our will to do battle, our awareness. We have to build a new and better world. Venezuela joins that struggle, and that's why we are threatened. The U.S. has already planned, financed, and set in motion a coup in Venezuela, and it continues to support coup attempts in Venezuela and elsewhere. President Michelle Bachelet reminded us just a moment ago, the horrendous assassination of the former Foreign Minister Orlando Letelier. And I would just add one thing. Those who perpetrated this crime are free. And that other event where an American citizen also died were Americans themselves. They were CIA killers, terrorists. And we must recall in this room that in just a few days there will be another anniversary. 30 years will have passed from this other horrendous terrorist attack on the Cuban plane where 73 innocents died, a Cubana de Aviación airliner. And where is the biggest terrorist of this continent who took the responsibility for blowing up the plane? He spent a few years in jail in Venezuela thanks to CIA And then government officials, he was allowed to escape, and he lives here in this country, protected by the government. And he was convicted. He has confessed to his crime. But the U.S. government has double standards. It protects terrorism when it wants to. And this is to say that Venezuela is fully committed to combating terrorism and violence, and we are one of the peoples who are fighting for peace. Luis Posada Carriles is the name of that terrorist who is protected here, and other tremendously corrupt people who escaped from Venezuela are also living here under protection. A group that bombed various embassies, that assassinated people during the coup, they kidnapped me and they were going to kill me, but I think God reached down and our people came out into the streets and the army was true, and so I'm here today. But these people who led that coup are here today in this country protected by the American government, and I accuse the American government of protecting terrorists and of having a completely cynical discourse. We mentioned Cuba. Yes, we were just there a few days ago. We just came from there, happily. And there you see another era born, the summit of the 15, the summit of the non-aligned, adopted a historic resolution. This is the outcome document. Don't worry, I'm not going to read it. But you have a whole set of resolutions here that were adopted after open debate in a transparent manner. More than 50 heads of state. Havana was the capital of the South for a few weeks, and we have now launched once again the group of the non-aligned with new momentum. And is there anything I could ask all of you here, my companions, my brothers and sisters? It is to please lend your into the streets, and the army was true, and so I'm here today. But these people who led that coup are here today in this country protected by the American government. And I accuse the American government of protecting terrorists and of having a completely cynical discourse. We mentioned Cuba. Yes, we were just there a few days ago. We just came from there, happily. And there you see another era born, the summit of the 15, the summit of the non-aligned, adopted a historic resolution. This is the outcome document. Don't worry, I'm not going to read it. But you have a whole set of resolutions here that were adopted after open debate in a transparent manner. More than 50 heads of state. Havana was the capital of the South for a few weeks, and we have now launched once again the group of the non-aligned with new momentum. And is there anything I could ask all of you here, my companions, my brothers and sisters? It is to please lend your goodwill, to lend momentum to the non-aligned movement for the birth of the new era, to prevent hegemony and to prevent further advances of imperialism. And as you know, Fidel Castro is the president of the non-aligned for the next 3 years, and we can trust him to lead the charge very efficiently. If unfortunately they thought, oh, Fidel was going to die, but they're going to be disappointed because he didn't, and he's not only alive, he's back in his green fatigues, and he's now presiding the non-aligned. So, my dear colleagues, Madam President, a new strong movement has been born, a movement of the South. We are men and women of the South. With this document, with these ideas, with these criticisms, I'm now closing my file. I'm taking the book with me, and don't forget, I'm recommending it very warmly and very humbly to all of you. We want ideas to save our planet, to save the planet from the imperialist threat. And hopefully, in this very century, in not too long a time, we will see this. We will see this new era, and for our children and our grandchildren, a world of peace based on the fundamental principles of the United Nations, but the renewed, a renewed United Nations. And maybe we have to change location. Maybe we have to put the United Nations somewhere else, maybe a city of the South. We've proposed Venezuela. You know that my personal doctor had to stay in the plane. The chief of security security had to be left in a locked plane. Neither of these gentlemen was allowed to arrive and attend the UN meeting. This is another abuse and another abuse of power on the part of the devil. It smells of sulfur here, but God is with us, and I embrace you all. May God bless us all. Good day to you.
On behalf of the General Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela for the statement just made. May I request representatives to remain seated while the Deputy Secretary General and I escort the President.
Now, Israeli Foreign Minister Tzipi Livni's address to the UN General Assembly. She spoke about the Israeli-Palestinian peace process and Iran's nuclear program.